Hello again, and welcome to Chapter 2. In this first section of the course, we'll be working together on a new project, writing some business logic. This will allow us to learn the principles of test-driven development in a practical way. In this chapter, I'm going to introduce the project that we'll be working on, and we'll set up our development environment. Then we'll be ready to start actually writing some tests and code in the next chapter. So here's the project. Let's imagine that we've been given the task to write some code which will check that an ISBN number is valid. If you've not come across ISBN numbers before, it stands for International Standard Book Number, and these are the numbers that you find on the barcode on all books. The final digit of each ISBN number is a check digit. This means that you can calculate what the final digit should be from the other numbers that make up the barcode. Because of this, if any single digit is wrong, it's not a valid ISBN. For example, 01404414192 is a valid ISBN number, but if we change one digit, for example the 9 to a 7, then it becomes an invalid ISBN number. For this to be valid, the final digit would also have to change. So we want to write some code that will take a full ISBN number, including its check digit, and will indicate whether or not this is a valid ISBN number. Now, if you want to look up what the rules are as to how to validate an ISBN number, then a good place to start would be with the Wikipedia page, which I've got on screen right now. But you don't need to read this, because as we progress through this project, we'll do a complete work through of the logic, and I'll explain that logic to you step by step. So let's set up the development environment. I've got Eclipse open here, and I've got no projects open at the moment. So I suggest you follow along with me throughout this course, and we'll start then by creating a new project. And I think we'll call this ISBN Validator. And we'll click on Finish. And I'm going to go and create a class in this project. And we'll call this class Validate ISBN. And I'd like to put it in a package. I think we'll pick com.virtualpairprogrammers.isbntools. And we'll click on Finish. Now, before we write any code in this class, we're going to create a unit testing class to work with. So let's go and create one of those. We'll click on File, New, and JUnit Test Case. Now, Eclipse has helpfully filled in some of the fields here for us, but let's go through them. At the top, we have the choice of whether we want to use JUnit 3 or 4. So we're going to pick JUnit 4, the most recent version of JUnit. In case you've not come across JUnit before, this is a testing framework for Java, and we'll be writing all of our tests using this framework. As you'll see, it not only gives us a few useful testing commands, but it integrates nicely into our development environment, allowing us to run the tests easily and to see which ones have passed or failed. Okay, so we're using JUnit 4. Now, the next line down here, this source folder, is asking us where we want to save our test case. There are a few different choices we could make about where to put our tests within the project. The most common convention is to create a separate folder to store your test code at the same level as SRC. Here's my project workspace, and if I go into the ISBN validator project that we've just created, we can see we've got an SRC and a bin folder. So the most common thing to do is to create another folder in here called test at the same level as SRC, and we'll place our tests in there. As I said, that's the most common convention, but there are some alternatives. Some people prefer to keep the files within SRC, within the main body of the project, but to use a different package name, such as isbntools.tests, for example. And in fact, you'll see we do that on the Java Fundamentals course and in some of the other courses here at Virtual Pair Programmers. We do that just to keep things simple, but also we're not really doing test-driven development in those other courses. We're using tests simply to validate a little bit of logic, so it maybe makes sense to include the tests next to the logic in that instance. When you're doing test-driven development, I think it makes more sense to have your tests in a separate place, so we'll not use a different package name. Now, some people favour keeping the tests in the SRC folder and in the same package name, but prefixing the name of the test with an underscore to indicate that it's a test class rather than a main class of the project. I really don't like this approach, particularly because we don't have to have a one-to-one relationship between the test class and the class that we are coding in. I actually think this is very messy, so we won't be doing that. We'll use the more common convention of storing our test classes in a separate test folder within the project. So we'll go and create that test folder, and I'm going to do it in Eclipse, but we'll need to click cancel here because we can't create it while we've got this window open. So let's click on cancel, and we'll right-click on the project and choose new and folder, and we'll call the folder test and click on finish. Now there is one further step we need to do here, which is we need to include this test folder in our build path. So we'll right click on it and click on build path and then use as source folder. And you might notice that it's now jumped up to be within the main part of our project. And if you can see, the folder icon has changed here as well. I can't really describe that icon, but you'll see it no longer looks like a standard folder. It's now got this extra little symbol there, which indicates it's part of our project structure. Okay, so we're now ready to create the test case. So let's once again click on File and New JUnit Test Case. And because I had test highlighted, it's now placed it in the test folder. So if yours didn't do that, if you still had SRC highlighted, just change that to the source folder of our project name, /test. Next, we're being asked for the package name. Now, it's best here to make this the same package name as the class that we are testing is using. In our instance, that's com.virtualprogrammers.isbntools. This isn't critical, but it avoids us having to do various imports when we want to create instances of this class within our tests. So let's just do that. That should be com.virtualprogrammers.isbntools. And we need to give our class a name. I think we'll call this a validate ISBN test. Of course, it can be any name at all. We might rename it later. For now, that will do. And we're going to ignore this section about method stubs for now. We will talk about that a bit later on in this course. But the last thing I do just want to mention is this field here, class under test. Now, this can be a useful feature sometimes when you're creating unit tests, but it's not something that's useful for test-driven development. What this feature does, if you say we're going to be testing our validate ISBN class, is it will create method stubs to test each of the different methods within our class. Now, right now, we don't have any methods within our validate ISBN class. It's an empty class. But this is useful, as I said, not in test-driven development, but if you were creating a test case after you'd written your class, the opposite to TDD, then this would generate some method stubs for you. Actually, that may or may not be useful. It's certainly not useful for us now, so we'll make sure this is blank. And then we're ready to click finish. We just need to click on OK here to make sure that JUnit is added to our build path. And we're now ready to start. We have a test class, and Eclipse has given us an example test here. Now, I'm not sure if you've used JUnit before, so in case you haven't, I'm just going to point out a couple of things. First of all, just above the method here, we've got an annotation of @test. This annotation unsurprisingly means that the method that follows is a test method. But it means that when we tell Eclipse we want to run all of our tests, this method will be run. It's the annotation that tells Eclipse this method is a test method. So it's important we have the annotation there. if we right-click on our workspace here and choose Run As and then JUnit Test, well, we'll see that down here, this test here is the name of the method. So because we had the at test annotation, this method was run. And we've got up here a red bar. If you remember, our workflow is red, green, refactor, and this is the red part. That means that one or more tests failed. Just above the red bar, we can see that we had one out of one test ran, no tests gave errors, but one test gave a failure. An error means that either the test code crashed or that the code that the test was running crashed. We had some kind of exception that wasn't handled. A failure means that the test didn't pass. On the bottom left of the screen here, we've got what's called the failure trace, and that will tell us what went wrong in our test. And what we've got here is an assertion error, and the error phrase is not yet implemented. Well, we can see here the phrase not yet implemented is part of our test. And actually, all this test does is it calls a method called fail. That is a JUnit method which says we want this test to fail. And that's what generates the assertion error. So this test failed because the only line of code in the test says, I want this code to fail. So that's what a failing test looks like. Let's see what a test that passes look like. And to do that, we'll just remove this fail line from the code. So we now have an empty method. We'll click on save. And well, to rerun this test, there's a couple of things we could do. We obviously could right click and choose run as and JUnit test again. We could click on this little play button up here to rerun the last run that we did. That was a JUnit run, so that would work. Or there is an icon up here which will rerun all the tests, or this one will rerun all the tests but test the failed ones first. Well, we've only got one test at the moment, so it doesn't matter which of these we click on. I normally always just click on rerun test. Okay, well, now we've got a green bar, so that tells us that all of our tests ran, and we can see that there was a test that ran. If I just click on this little arrow, the drop down, we can see that our method called test passed. We've got a little green tick here as well to tell us that, and there's nothing in the failure trace. So thinking back once again to our workflow, which is red, green, refactor, well, here's the green. We've got a green bar that tells us our tests are passing. So the red and the green refer to the colour of this bar. Okay, well, that's been a little introduction to JUnit. We've got our workspace up and running now, so we're ready to actually start writing some tests and some code. We'll do that in the next chapter, and I'll see you there.